Daddy.
Bye, guys.
Bye.
We'll see you in a little bit.
Have fun at the beach.
Is he taking photos?
No, he's going to take a video. He's going to show all of the people of his regrets. Say hasta luego.
Hasta luego.
Bye, guys. Have fun.
Bye.
Bye.
Hey guys, welcome back to Gilligan Phantom. We are a family of three who turned this big school bus into a tiny house, and we started it 2.5 years ago, and I gotta say, back then, we had no idea what we were in for. We didn't know how to do any of this work, we didn't know exactly where our lives were gonna take us, but we had a penchant for researching, problem solving, and really just never giving up. That is the key in the end, is you have to just make yourself do the work, which is why I came up with the motto, let's do something on the bus. It doesn't have to be perfect, it doesn't have to be what you hope to accomplish, but you got to do something. Yay, it's a new day. Let's do something on the bus. Do the work, do the best that you can. And really, that's what we did. It took us 2 years to turn this into a house, and we are really, really pleased and happy with the results. But I do have some regrets. So this video is my 7 Skoolie regrets. The last one is the most important. If you guys want to see more videos about Skoolies or life on the road or living in a mobile dwelling, hit that subscribe button. All right, let's get into this. All right, so here's regret number one. I happen to be standing around it right now, and it's not specifically that I regret the marine hatch. I think this thing is super lovely, and I love having it. But what I do regret is not building in active ventilation into this bus. I wanted to somehow fit a skylight, ventilation, and roof access all into one, which is why I splurged on this marine hatch. But what I didn't realize was that this was not going to be adequate ventilation for us. We can't open it or leave it open in the rain, and it doesn't actually send air out with power like a fan would. I should have built in ventilation with fantastic fans or max air fans. I still could put one like right here, but now that the build is over, it'd be a lot more complicated. There's big metal framing in here, and I don't know exactly where it is. And so I'm kind of just stuck with the hatch. But it would be much nicer to have air flowing all the time through 2 or 3 max air fans. And then we wouldn't have to have fans kind of like out in our world, like that one right there, and that one right there. And while we're here, this is a little bonus one. This is definitely a serious regret. I feel really silly about this. I bought this $100 cute white marine fan. Hello, new fan. After a year of it running constantly, it just broke. I guess I was expecting too much of it, but it did cost $100 and it's made for yachts. We took it down. We're just left with this extremely ugly pile of wiring and dirt. I installed these little electrical lines here because I thought I would be able to get a fan that like flipped out this way and sent air out when I wanted it to. And that's kind of what this little white fan did, but it was so dinky and insignificant that we hardly ever did it. And then it broke and now it's just an ugly thing. In your Skoolie build, I recommend that you build in active ventilation. Now my second Skoolie regret is sort of trivial in some ways. It's not crucial that I had done this. If you look at my ceiling, I did 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 furring strips. I remember at the time I was looking at photos from real professional Skoolie builders, and they were using like 11 furring strips all the way across the ceiling. And I was like, man, I don't see why that would be necessary. That would be so much more work. I'm just gonna do 6. It is sort of unnecessary, and yes, it is more work, but I would have had many more attachment points for attaching my ceiling, and I could have probably pulled off what I was attempting to do with this ceiling, where like these seams would just kind of blend into the visual and you'd hardly see it. But that's not what happened. I didn't have enough attachment points, and so I wasn't able to control this as well as I could have. Ever since, basically, I've needed to put a strip to cover it, but I've just never done it because it was never my goal to have a ceiling that looked like that. I've just sort of accepted it for the way that it is. And also, if you were building interior walls that run the length of the bus, you would have a lot more options for where to place them and make them extremely secure by having more furring strips. With the way that our ceiling is set up, it's still okay. Like, we screwed just into the 1/8 ply. It would have been a little bit more professional to have 9 to 11 furring strips instead of just 6. Regret number 3 is not really a regret. It's kind of a pros and cons list about spray foam. Spray foam is a 2-part chemical reaction. When they're separate, they are like completely toxic and disgusting. And they're put together with pressure if spray foam is not applied perfectly by a professional. Maybe the kits at Home Depot are a little bit different. We didn't use that. The results can be toxic. If your spray foam doesn't mix right, it's going to be horrible for your build. And you really can't take it out once it's there. You can't remove spray foam. And so it's a bit of a danger having a professional that you haven't vetted, don't know if you can trust or not, don't know if they're having a bad day, install spray foam for you. And it's even more of a danger, in my opinion, to do it yourself. Let's talk about the pros and cons of spray foam. The first one is that it's the best R value. And the second one is that it creates structural rigidity and sound dampening in your schoolie. It is the best insulation, but it's really close to your living space. It's not like it's going in your ventilated attic. It's right by your head. It's right by your body. There could be health problems for you, especially if you're sensitive to chemicals. There's other insulation products. There's ones that are basically made out of sheep's wool. I'm not super well versed in them. They do work well too, and they are environmentally friendly, and they are friendly to you and your chemical sensitivity. I think that they could be worth a consideration because something happens with the ceiling of the bus, because the bus is all metal and metal conducts temperature very easily. So if you have the sun beating down on your bus in a place like Lake Powell, where we were last time that I made a video like this, I think that that sun is actually going to heat up your bus so much because of all of the thermal mass in the ceiling through the spray foam and all the thermal mass with the wood and the countertops and everything in here. The hot spray foam is actually going to keep that temperature in here. We actually had our friend Jessica from Painted Buffalo Studio pull in, and her bus, even though it had no air conditioning, was slightly cooler because she had way less thermal mass in the ceiling, and she didn't have active ventilation, but even just with the windows open and less thermal mass, her bus was kind of cooler. Not in the bedroom where we have an air conditioner, but in the front of the bus where we have all of our windows and no AC. If you're going to keep all of your windows, if you're going to have active ventilation, you're going to be traveling like with the temperature. Maybe you don't want to spray foam your bus. Maybe you don't want to like fill the bus with all that thermal mass that would keep heat in, because there's other ways to do it. Now, if you're building a bus that has RV windows, dual pane, like you're going to be in cold climates, you need to heat the inside of the bus. You want it to be comfortable. Spray foam, RV windows, that's the way to go. Like there's really no way around it. But if you're going to be in hot weather most of the time and you're not going to be like using air conditioning, maybe spray foam is not the solution for you. Just think about it. Think about where you're going to be in your bus most of the time. I want to be in hot places. That's what I like. That was quite a ramble. All right, regret number four. I'm actually a little bit embarrassed about. We're gonna have to go outside so I can show it to you. At the time, it was the no-brainer solution to holding our gray water. The problem is it doesn't actually have significant fittings for draining it. And so what you have to do is you have to either cut and plastic weld a dump fitting into this, or you need to use one of those rubber seals. Now, if we flash back to when I was installing this gray water tank, I was trying to knock it out before a thunderstorm came in, and I didn't feel great about cutting the big hole in the side of the tank for the seal. All right guys, so I feel really rushed in the rain and I do not want to mess that 3-inch hole up. So I'm bailing for now. I was pressed for time and I didn't trust that rubber seal, but I did cut it into the top of the tank and it's actually leaking. So when this tank is close to full and we're driving around and the gray water is sloshing around the place, it actually pops up through the top and sits on top of the tank and spills over to the side. And the reason I'm embarrassed by that is because our pee is in there now, because we routed the composting toilet pee to the gray water tank, and it smells really gross. And it's spilling into my undercarriage. Like, man, I gotta take everything out of there, clean it, but I haven't done that because it's going to happen again. This is what I would do differently, I guess. Black water tanks have dump valves built into them. They're at the very bottom of the tank, and you can really quickly drain all the contents of it, unlike with this gray water tank. The thing is, they only make like 50 gallons is the max size that they make, and I have 100 fresh, so I wanted 100 gray. At the time, we were trying to get into the bus as quickly as possible so that we could live in it. So this solution really did make sense then. As it stands, it's really inadequate. You can't dump the whole contents. I have to dump really slowly out of a 3/4-inch hose. It's not ideal. It's a regret. In the future,
or if I could do it again, and I might even change this because this is really bothering me. 2 50-gallon black water tanks, not in the undercarriage. I think I'd put them back there.
While we are outside, this is Skoolie regret number 5. This is something that I also did to get us into the bus quickly, and that's that I mounted the mini split right there. That has absolutely worked out fine. It functions great. It was the easiest way to install it. Like, the reasons for doing it were worthy. But aesthetically, it's the one thing about this bus. Everything's so cool and sleek and black and yellow and just like seamless until you get to the back. And then there's this big white clunky thing that hangs off the back of it. There was a lot of other solutions. Ideally, I could fit it in the engine bay if I moved my air intake around. There's other places I could fit it, but at the time it was too much work. I didn't have metalworking tools. I couldn't find a welder to build something for me. And I said, we need to get into this bus. We need air conditioning. And I mounted it on the back. I regret it just because of the aesthetics. It's not crucial. If you want to put it on the back, or if you already did put it on the back, I really think it's a smart way to go. It was so easy and it's been functioning really well. All right, moving back inside, regret number 6 is the layout. I want to preface this by saying that I think we designed one of the most functional, aesthetically pleasing Skoolies I've come across. And I really, really love this. This is incredible. But there's something that I would do differently if I could, and that's to do with the bathroom. Now, if you notice in here, our shower across from our toilet has this big hallway. And right here, we have another big hallway. One of these hallways is redundant and doesn't need to exist. And so if I could do this again, just to save space, I would put the shower or the toilet across from the shower or the toilet, and then I would have the bathroom hallway be the actual hallway. And that way you wouldn't have this redundancy and this wasted floor space. And the reason I would do that is going to lead us into the final regret, regret number 7, the one that I really want you guys to know about and think about before buying your Skoolie. So if I had reoriented the bathroom a little bit and made it the way I just described, and maybe cut just a little bit more space, I really love these couches and this incredible amount of social space, but I actually think that I could get adequate social space and also dinettes right here and maybe cut some of this off. I think that if I were to do it again, I might do something like dinette across from dinette, and it would all collapse into a big sleeper for 2 people, and also a lounge area for maybe like watching something on a projector back there. And then you would have your social area. You wouldn't be able to like super lounge on a couch or lay out on a couch, but you could break it all down to lay on it, and you could actually cut some of this off. Like, maybe you could take all this out. I don't know that Val exactly feels the same way about this that I do. I could have reoriented this living room to be a little bit shorter and still gotten a ton out of it. But I mean, as it stands, it's really, really nice. Like, I don't want this to really sway you, because I think this is a really pleasant living area. And this is a huge, fun bus to live in. But regret number 7, I'm like a little bit embarrassed and sad to say it, because so many other Skoolie people who have built a Skoolie and then lived a fast-paced life on the road have said this, and that is, at least for us, we don't need a 40-foot bus. We don't. It's actually a little bit too long. And the reason it's too long is because it's not that I can't do almost anything with this bus. I've done extremely crazy backup maneuvers without a spotter in this thing and been totally fine. But at the end of the day, driving this adds a level of stress to my life that I think I could mitigate by having 5 to 10 feet less bus behind me. Now, I would never give up the pusher. I would never give up the diesel engine in the back. I would never accept it in the front of the bus, and I wouldn't drive a dog nose because I love the viewing angle from the front of this bus. And I love having the engine all the way back there, and I love having it be a really powerful engine. If they made like a 32-foot, or they make a 35-foot diesel pusher, it's easy to find. Don't settle for a 40-footer unless you have a large family and you really need the space for bunk beds, because you just don't need 40 feet. I could easily chop 5 to 10 feet off this with slight layout changes and have the same general bus. If you already have a 40-foot bus, make it work. Like, it's totally doable. I'm not saying that I'm going to chop 10 feet off the bus or get a new bus or anything like that. I'm just saying that driving it would be less stressful. I would have more options in terms of national parks that you can enter, because some national parks don't allow 40-foot buses. They just don't have space for it. And I would have less stress during some of the maneuvering around campgrounds, where I've got big trees on the sides of me, and like the
campground is made for smaller vehicles. It's just that they can accommodate 40 footers. You can do it. I'm rambling here. You can do anything in a 40 foot bus except for go to some national parks, but you might not have to, which means you might not have to pay for the extra expense in the build, and you might not have to pay for it with the stress of driving the 40 footer. I can tell you now, if I had a 30 foot bus, wow, it would be really easy to just whip that thing around. I might even consider putting a tow car on the back, because then I wouldn't have to do so much backing up to get out of tricky situations. I could loop around more easily. But we ended up falling for Gilligan Phantom. He's a 40 footer. There was no way around it. There's so many pros to this platform. The Gillig Phantom bus is just a total beast. Great headroom, fantastic undercarriage storage, a powerful engine. I really wanted a 32 footer, and if I could do it again, I would get somewhere between 30 and 35 feet. If you made it this far into the video and you want to see videos about living in a mobile dwelling, living on the road, building a mobile dwelling, hit that subscribe button. We want you guys along for the ride. And check out our website, schoolbustinyhouse.com. I think there's a ton of value in there for you if you're building a schoolie, so check it out. Thank you for watching, and we will see you next time.
Bye.
Bye, guys. Have fun at the beach.
Bye, refrigerator door.
Goodbye, refrigerator door.
Is that what you're going to miss, the refrigerator door?
Yep.
Okay.